This is a list of awards and accomplishments of Professor Berry. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Professor Sir Michael Berry. Professor Berry received his PhD in theoretical physics in 1965 from St. Andrews University of Scotland. He's best known for the discovery of geometric phase, not named after him. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of Arts, a fellow of the Royal Institution, a foreign member of the Royal Society of Netherlands, and a foreign member of the United States National Academy of Sciences. His many awards include the Wolf Prize in Physics, Royal Medal of the Royal Society, Naylor Prize of the London Mathematical Society, Paul Dirac Medal and Prize of the Institute of Physics, Kapitsa Medal of the Russian Academy of Sciences, Julius Edgar Lilienfeld Prize of the American Physical Society, and the Polya Prize of the London Mathematical Society. He has many more, as you can see. He also shared with Andrei Geim the 2000 Ig Nobel Prize in Physics for elucidating the physics of flying frogs. Honest to God, that's... At last count, he had 468 publications listed on his website, plus 5 papers awaiting publication. He was also writing something in the hotel lobby yesterday while waiting for me to pick him up. Presumably, there are a couple more papers in the works as we speak. I have had the honor and the privilege of knowing Sir Michael personally since the summer of 2005, when we first met at a conference in London. It's amazing how much one can learn during each minute of every hour spent in his company. It's only a slight exaggeration to say that he knows everything and can explain everything. A different way of putting it is what he knows not is not knowledge. The only problem with hosting Professor Berry is that you cannot surprise him by anything that you say. He guesses the punchline of every one of your jokes. Professor Berry gave a wonderful public lecture yesterday on how quantum physics democratized music. Tomorrow at 3 p.m., he will give the Joint Physics Applied Math Colloquium on super oscillations and weak measurement. The title of today's lecture at our College of Optical Sciences is The Singularities of Light, Intensity, Phase, Polarization. Without further ado, allow me to invite Sir Michael to the podium.
Exaggeration, but I appreciate the generosity. Well, as I said yesterday, it is lovely to be back in Tucson. I'm having traveled just the other day, I'm still waking up at curious times of night. So although I very well know where I am, I'm not quite sure when I am. Sometimes, often, one gives talks about what one did last week, technical talks on specific topics, advances. But that's not what I want to do today. Some of the stuff that I'll talk about, some of you, older people, may recognize from rather long ago, and some of it is indeed quite recent. But I want to give you a big picture. That's why I've chosen not to concentrate just on the last few papers. The theme is this, that... not that. As well as understanding light, or waves generally, but let's talk about light, especially in this institute, in terms of solutions of wave equations and theoretical optics, I mean, in terms of solutions of wave equations, either analytically, if you can, or on the computer, mapping out wave fields and the like, or experimentally, similarly. There's another way of looking at light, which has grown up in the last few decades, and that is to understand the different levels of description of light through their singularities. It's a very natural thing to do, and it's a little bit surprising that it wasn't a pervasive theme in our science in former eras. It's a natural thing to do because if you have any physical theory or formalism, the singularities are the natural places to which your gaze is most immediately driven because they describe dramatic phenomena. And in the case of optics, there are singularities, as my title implies, in phase, in intensity, in phase, and in polarization. And that's the structure of this talk. So let's start with singularities of intensity. Those who know me well know that I rarely can give a lecture without describing the rainbow. So I'm going to start with that. Okay, that's a nice singularity. Or at least it would be if geometrical optics were the truth and if the sun were a point and if water were not dispersive. But anyway, here it is. And Francis Bacon said the rainbow is sunshine on a dripping cloud. Well, here we have a raindrop. And here we have some rays coming in and some rays coming out. And they come in uniformly, but they don't come out uniformly. They come out focused in direction. And that means that once you rotate about this axis because of the spherical structure of a raindrop, you realize that from every raindrop there emerges a bright cone of light, lit inside and not lit outside, and bright because the light is concentrated more strongly in this focal rainbow direction. And on the ground, looking up, you see, brightly lit, all those raindrops on whose cones your eyes are situated. And you think about it a bit, and that's a bow. Okay. Now, if you plot the deflection as a function of the latitude of incidence, light is uniformly incident because the sun is so far away. And it's a curve that folds. And that means that within the rainbow, beyond the rainbow angle, every emergent angle is reached by two rays. Here are two of them, and they come out in the same direction. Okay, so the you can think of this as a two-to-one map, mathematically. That's what the deflection is. And as you look towards the bow, these two roots come together and they coalesce. And when they do, the slope is zero, so a little dx comes out in a little d2d, a lot goes into a little, that's what focusing is, and that's a singularity of the map, and that's the caustic in the space of directions. Good, 2-to-1 map. Here's a many-to-1 map, that's the sun sparkling on the surface of actually Lake Como, and how does that work? It's a gradient map, that's Fermat's principle. You have the optical distance, phi, from the sun to the eye via the water, and that depends on position on the lake, that's where you're looking, and it depends on other parameters like time, the waves are waving, or the position of your eye and the angle of the sun, all of that. And the places that you see brightly lit, of course, are the solutions of this stationarity of optical distance, and that equivalent to Archimedes' law of equal angles of incidence and reflection. And as the water waves, these points move about and they coincide in pairs and disappear, or they're born in pairs. But of course, the singularity of the map, this coalescence of two, but what it corresponds to is in the space above the water, there are these caustic surfaces. And they move around, and when one of them passes your eye, you looking down see this coalescence. And it's a stationarity to higher order. The Hessian vanishes. Now, describing this kind of... you don't usually see these individual events, unless you're very close to the water. You see them collectively, and that's what gives rise to the sparkling of the sea. So the sparkling is a succession of singularities of a many-to-one gradient map. That's what sparkling is, okay, mathematically. Whoops, ouch. Here we are again. You see a whole glitter path, but when you look closely, you still see the individual images, brilliant points. Now, mathematically, These things are the subject of something called catastrophe theory. The dramatic name is for another application, not relevant today. And what the theory describes is the different ways in which these coalescences can happen stably. That means ways which, under perturbation, can be deformed smoothly into each other. And you can call that natural focusing, as distinct from the desired point focus in a lens that you learn about in high school, which is very contrived focusing. It's very unstable, and that's why lens making is difficult. So it's in a sense the opposite to lens making optics, this type of study of focusing. Well, let me just take you through a little list of a classification. It's classification by codimension, the number of dimensions you need to find something. Now, what I showed you with the rainbow is the fold catastrophe. The curve folds over, it's descriptive. So that's codimension one. In space, there's a caustic surface, three dimensions. You need one dimension to find it. And there's a what the theory gives you is a series of what are called normal forms, these polynomials, which represent, they're one member of a universality class, and you get all possible members of this class by smoothly deforming any nonlinear whatever transformation, provided it's not singular. I won't go into that. Oh, here's the pair, of course. As you change the one parameter, these two roots come together. It was the opposite terminology from what I used before. Never mind. Two dimensions, it's the cusp. These are not enormously surprising. It will come to surprises in a minute. And that's where two folds come together, codimension two. In three dimensions, it's a line. So you need two dimensions to find it, x and y, and there's a normal form for that. And the cusp shape is the semi-cubical parabola, x is y to the 3/2. Here's an illustration of a set of rays which envelop this cusp singularity. One ray outside, three rays inside, that's some initial wavefront, for example. Okay, you've all seen these curves inside cups lit, whose inside surface is lit and projected onto... I should have used milky coffee, it's better to see, but by diffuse reflection you see this cusp. If it's a plastic cup and you squeeze it, you can see this move around, and occasionally you can see a pair of cusps being born at a particular event, and that's a higher singularity. There's a sculptor who lives near me in England, and she makes sculptures she calls light catchers, Suzanne Redstone, and puts them in parks where they're lit by the sun and you get these nice shapes. Three dimensions, codimension three, it starts to become less obvious what the mathematics tells you, because there are three stable singularities. So the first is a swallowtail, that's where two cusp edges come together, that's a point in three dimensions. And by the way, there's no reason to stop at three, because you can have any parameters as well that control your optical system, and you can get higher and higher singularities, which I won't go into. Names... reasons I won't describe. Elliptic umbilic, that's where three come together at a point, codimension three, and hyperbolic umbilic is where you have a smooth outer surface and a cusp inner surface which meet, and they intersect at a place where there's a corner. Now, you can use this stability to predict things, because when you see something that isn't on the mathematician's list of stable singularities, you know there must be some fine structure or some symmetry operating. Well, here, David Hockney painted pictures of his friends swimming, and you see the caustics. He made his pictures from numerous photographs that he took, and then he drew what he saw. And here you see these caustics. Now, they often come together in threes. Now, lines coming together in threes are common in other areas of physics. Mud cracks, the joining of the plates of an armadillo, for example. Lots of places where lines meet in threes. But I haven't shown you on this little list so far, and we're only in two dimensions, I haven't shown you any lines coming together in threes, and that's because they're not stable. It's not possible mathematically to have, without symmetry, these triple junctions. That tells you there must be some fine structure. Indeed, there is. Fine structure is several possible fine structures, which we see in observation. Why don't we see them, the fine structure there? Because the sun isn't a point. It blurs things out. It's half a degree. And also they moved too quickly for you to see. Here's two impossible junctions. And the one way of resolving them, which happens, is that you get these pairs and you get these cusp-centered triple junctions. So that's the first. And we have observations on rippling water when you look in detail from point sources where you can see these structures. And another is more fun is when you have an elliptic umbilic center, these little triangles, triple junctions, and you see that in this structure is what the triple junction resolves into, and you see that in observation. You see a lot of interference here, which we'll come to. Okay. Here's a wonderful example, a marvelous example, the best known to me, of understanding what's stable and what's not. It wasn't described this way by the discoverers, but it's what it is. So in 1976, the star Epsilon Geminorum was occulted by the planet Mars. That's a rare thing, you know. Mars is some tiny little thing to occult a reasonable size brightness star. Well, that means that the star briefly disappeared into the shadow of Mars. And at least it would do if Mars didn't have an atmosphere. But it does. It has an atmosphere that focuses starlight. And it focuses in such a way that you'd get a focal line in the middle here. And so in the shadow, you expect there to be a little central bright flash. So as Mars moves across, now the starlight would go out, but in the middle you'd see this little flash. In fact, the caustic would be this, but this spun cusp is far outside and you wouldn't see it, away from the Earth, so this is what you would see. The astronomers in an airborne observatory knew this. They wanted to fly to see this structure, and indeed there you see it. It's a period of a few minutes. There's the light of the star going out, and there's the central flash and so on. But they knew something else. They knew, as we know from catastrophe theory, that this focal line is unstable to perturbation. It's not anywhere in the list of catastrophes. It would have codimension 2. It's a line, but it's not a cusp edge. So it's not possible to survive perturbation. And what the symmetry is broken by the fact that Mars isn't a sphere. Well, what would happen? Actually, what does happen is that this unfolds into this four-cusp thing. And that means that because Mars isn't a sphere, there will be fine structure in that central flash. And they calculated, the astronomers, that the path of the telescope crossed this asteroid bright line on the surface of the Earth. And so they'd go close to the cusp, but they'd see these two spikes. So they predicted that in a few seconds, if they looked into that central flash, they would see a maximum there, and they would see these two spikes. If that's a telephone, if it's for me, please tell them I'm busy. Okay? And I'll talk to them later. Well, that's what they saw. I think it's fantastic. I don't know a better example of a symmetry-breaking perturbation generating a structurally stable singularity. So that's what happened on that day. Okay. But of course, light isn't rays, it's waves, we know. So geometric velocity is an approximation. So let's look at what happens to waves near caustics. Well, here you see what I would show you if security people would allow me to bring a powerful green laser in my hand luggage, which is all I travel with, and I would shine it through a piece of irregular corrugated bathroom window glass in front of you, and there on the screen you would see a pattern like this. The width of the laser beam, a millimeter or so, being about the same size as the corrugations in the glass plate. So different rays in the beam get refracted differently and hit different bits of the screen because it's coherent. Where more than one ray hits, you get interference, and the boundaries between regions reached by different numbers of rays are the caustics. And you see a fold, you see a cusp, and you see incipient hyperbolic umbilics. You need another dimension for them, and if you have the third dimension, these would come together in a corner, and that would be a singularity of codimension 3. Okay, well, let's have a look at waves generating caustics, these interference fringes. There's a beautiful property that they have. You see, with waves, you've got a new quantity. Let's talk about monochromatic waves, which is the wave number or the wavelength. And that appears, so the waves depend on that. And we're talking about large K, because this is high frequency and small wavelength, near geometrical optics. And amazingly and beautifully, the singularity is described by the polynomials. You have a wave at particular values of these parameters C, position, for example, or time, satisfy a scaling law, which has a lot of physics in it. And here it is. The wave with wave number K at some place is the wave with wave number 1 scaled, with K appearing in the form of two types of exponent. This one, beta, describes an obvious thing, how quickly the intensity rises at the singularity itself, call it C equals 0, as the wavelength gets smaller, and the geometrical singularity would be infinitely bright, emerges. So that tells you how it emerges, inverse wavelength to the 2 beta, intensity is psi squared. Good. Now what are these other exponents? Well, the other thing that happens, of course, is that diffraction fringes, interference fringes, get smaller and smaller as the wavelength gets smaller, but they're not proportional to the wavelength, as in two-slit interference. Here, they're proportional to powers, inverse powers of the wavelength, or powers of the wavelength. Okay. Now, what is this psi? Well, it's a diffraction integral. We call them diffraction catastrophes. And what it is, instead of taking the derivative with respect to these variables, position on the C, whatever, you have in diffraction integrals generally, diffraction patterns, you have an integral, you integrate. And you integrate I times the phase. And this has the property, if you put in all this scaling and put K back again, it's IK times an optical distance, which is dimensionless. And these polynomials have a mathematical property which leads to these scaling laws. Okay. Of course, this is a highly oscillatory integral if K is large, and most of the contributions vanish. The ones that don't are ones where this is stationary, but they're the rays again. Very good. Except that the simple technique you use, method of stationary phase, to approximate integrals under these circumstances, assumes that the rays are separate from each other. And exactly on caustics, the most important places, they come together. And then you can't approximate these integrals. You have to look at them sui generis and study them one by one. And they're wonderful. So the list of polynomials, geometrical singularities, caustics, gives you a list of diffraction patterns. It's actually a new class of special functions. If you look at the DLMF, Digital Library of Mathematical Functions, Google it if you don't know it. It's the grown-up version of Abramovitz and Stegun Handbook of Mathematical Functions, which, as we all us theorists know, this 1960s compendium, but now it's on the web, much magnified and free to anybody. Most of the functions are the same ones that were in the old compendium, but there's a new chapter on these diffraction catastrophes, because it's a different class of functions, apart from the first one, which was a member of the class of Bessel functions, but the others are not. So if you look up, you'll see pictures of these diffraction catastrophes, which I'll take you through a little bit now. So here, the first one is the Airy function. There's Airy, and here's a fold catastrophe, and here are the caustics. It's a magnification of a bit of that experimental picture that I showed you earlier. With rainbows, of course, the two rays that come out in any direction interfere with each other. That's for one raindrop. Now, if the raindrops are nearly the same size, that depends on meteorology, if they're not too big, that means the fringes are not too small, and they're not blurred out by the half width of the sun, you do see some nice supernumerary rainbows, as they're called, inside the main bow. They're interference fringes. And the scaling law is such that beta is 1/6. That means the intensity here rises as the inverse one-third power, of the wavelength. And the scale of the fringes is wavelength to the two-thirds. Now, that means something. You see, wavelength to the two-thirds, divided appropriately de-dimensionalized, is bigger than wavelength to the one, which means that the fringes get bigger when you're near to a acoustic, which is why you can see them in the sky with such a relatively big thing as a raindrop compared to the wavelength of light. But you can, there they are. Here's another one, you see nice fringes. Here's one from my office I took a few months ago. Very good. Oh yes, Kelvin's ship wave pattern behind a moving ship, or in this case a duck, is acaustic. It's acaustic of the rays of water waves. There it is again, and there it is. I had an email from someone in New Zealand asking how this pattern was produced. It was a computer graphics person, I explained and sent him the code for this surface, which is, here's the caustic, it's this V shape, always has the same angle, across here is the airy function, and that's how this is calculated. And apparently, it hasn't happened yet, they're going to use this to simulate the wakes of ships in Google Ocean. There is a mock-up somewhere, but they don't get it quite right because they've got the wakes of ships going over the land nearby. But they will, I'm sure, get it right. Well, that was fun. But that's an example. Now, in the cusp, let's go up one, you have Pierce's integral from 1946. Airy's integral is related to Bessel functions of order 1/3. The higher ones are not in that class at all. This one isn't. Here you've got the two variables, C1 and C2, call it, two parameters. And here's the interference pattern, color-coded, red being bright. Now, here you've got these exponents. Beta is 1/4. Intensity rises as inverse wavelength to the 1/2. Now, the two fringe size exponents are different in the two directions. In particular, crosswise, the fringes are smaller than lengthwise, or they would be when if the K, appropriately de-dimensionalized, is very large. And that's why, if you go out at night time wearing glasses, and it's raining, never rains here probably, but it does in England, raindrops fall on your glasses, not as clean as you thought they were, so you have raindrops, irregular lenses on the lenses. And if you look at a distant street light point source, you see it distorted into a pattern with lots of cusps. Now you can see the diffraction fringes of this pattern in, if you look carefully with your naked eye. If you don't wear glasses, you use the windshield of your car, but stop the car before you do this. You have to look very close. Okay. And then you find that because the raindrops are much larger than the wavelength of light, this anisotropy really matters. And you see the pattern enormously stretched. So you're seeing directly this anisotropic scaling with your own eyes. Something else I will concentrate on later, which are these pairs of zeros. Pairs of completely black points, complete destructive interference, a little bit later. In three dimensions, I'm just going to show you, for a particular reason, the diffraction pattern of the elliptic umbilic. Now, that's a pattern in three dimensions, okay? And you could scan it section by section. Here's a typical section. Here's a three cusp with all this fantastic interference detail. It's an interference pattern of four spatially varying geometrical optics. Rays. Now, the corresponding integral is now a double integral, but here's the X, Y, and Z, or Z, I should say here, describing this three-dimensional pattern. And it has a fantastic structure, which I will tell you a little bit about. First, I'll tell you how it was observed, measured experimentally, studied. If you take a piece of glass sheet, and you cover it with a piece of black tape, and then take a knife and cut a little triangle out, pick out this little triangle, you know, and drop a water droplet into that triangular hole, you can show from surface tension theory that the shape of it will generate below one of these elliptic umbilic diffraction patterns or focusing patterns. Now you might think You put this in a microscope, you need to change your focus, depth of focus of your microscope up and down to scan the pattern. You don't have to, because the heat of the laser beam evaporates the drop and the pattern sweeps its way through your focal plane and you can take pictures of it as it does so. And this was an idea of my colleague in this work, John Nye. Anyway, here's the central bit of pattern, experimentally. That's the central, there are two rays interfering outside. Okay, and it just happens to be expressible in closed form, that integral. Not obvious, by the way. There. But here you go a little bit outside, and you start to see the three cusp emerging, and you see this little structure of black zero rings. Here you go far outside, and you see this has an almost crystallographic structure. And it's crystallographic in Z as well as in X and Y. It has a particular symmetry group, if you know that dialect, that's what it is. Now, the pattern of zero lines is very rich, and I want to tell you something about it. If you look sideways, you take a section like this, then here is an intensity pattern, and here is a little bit of the pattern of rings. If you look down on it, you see these rings. They're not quite circular. They're not flat. They're puckered. You have this shape if you look sideways. And that's where the cusp is. And that's where the fold is there. And there are lines of them. This is the first line. First, second, third. I'm not going to show you the others. But now notice that as you go along here, the rings turn into a hairpin. And you might ask this question, how many rings are there before you get a hairpin measured from the center? Well, there's an answer to that, and you get it from studying the integral. These are the projections of the rings and the hairpin. And there are 14 there. You count them, 1, 2, 3, up to 14. But that's only the first row. So you ask the general mth row, how many are there? Well, here's the answer. It's the integer part of 256m over 13 divided by 269.50 seconds. Now, why am I telling you this apart from sort of infantile machismo? I'm telling you because all this is contained in that integral. Now, that integral describes in a stable way, near any elliptic umbilic, stable type of focusing, what happens to waves near the geometrical optics limit, which illustrates the fact that the geometrical optics limit, if you really keep coherence and look at the interference, is a very singular thing. It contains all this structure. You don't just go smoothly over to geometrical optics. And that has implications for the philosophical problem of reduction of theories. That's another lecture, and you won't get it today. But almost all of the transitions between theories in physics are singular in this sense, quantum to classical and so on. And this is just a beautiful concrete illustration of what richness is contained in this type of limit if you look at it carefully enough. Okay, that's singularities of intensity. Now let's talk about singularities of phase. And in fact, they are precisely these zeros, many of you know this, precisely these zeros I mentioned before. So this is much ado about nothing. Okay? And the nothing is points of perfect destructive interference. Now, taking monochromatic waves, and we're talking still about scalar waves, although light is that to an approximation, which we'll undo later. We have a complex wave, and zeros mean that the real part must vanish and the imaginary part must vanish. And that has codimension too, so they're lines in space, or points in the plane. Okay, so let's think about them a little bit. Facing, as I said. So here's the cusp again. Of course, phase is the additional quantity that comes in when you go from rays to waves, and we're talking about its singularity. So let's look at the phase. I didn't show you, I should show you the intensity. It's natural to color code phase using hue, because that's a periodic variable, and phase is that too. Well, let's have a look. There we are. The constant colour is constant phase. The points of where all the colours meet are the places where the phase is undefined. Of course, if you have a zero, you don't know what the phase is. It's like asking, what's the time at the North Pole? There we are. Now, this concept of phase singularity is, of course, vastly more general than simply applying to these waves which are near geometrical. So something that's not geometrical optics at all, you add random waves, monochromatic, let's say, all the same wavelength, but traveling in different directions. And there's the intensity, and there are some dark places there, and here's the phase. And every zero has this pattern close to it. This is fine scale wave physics. This is two square wavelengths. Many applications, you in optics know speckle patterns, of course, is section of black body radiation that pervades the universe, electron waves in a chaotic quantum dot. There are many reasons for studying these random waves. It's a large subject which I will not embark on, although I have a whole lecture about it. It's the finest scale of wave physics. There is indeed a one wavelength. They were discovered not in light, but in the tides by William Whewell, one of these impossible to pronounce English names. He was following up an idea of Thomas Young, who realized that his idea of wave interference applies to the tides. The tides are a 12-hour wave driven by the moon, girdling the Earth. And he realized that, of course, you've got continents and you get the waves of bounce, they're diffracted, they interfere with each other. And he said, Young, it's good to study what he called the co-tidal lines. These are the lines on the surface of the sea where at any instant the tide is high. Because you see them as places on the coast where you see high tide, but they exist on the ocean as well. And they're the wave fronts of the tide wave. And he said these should be studied. And William Whewell in the 1830s did this study. He embarked on a collaboration with lots of sea captains in around Britain. And that's his picture. He deduced that there have to be these singular points. He just realized topologically from the observations this must happen. Zooming in, there's that one. There's England. This is what was called the German Ocean in those days. And there it is. Of course, we recognize it as a phase singularity. Airy didn't like it. Airy was a much better mathematician than Whewell, but he got this wrong. He couldn't understand how this could... how you could have such a place. And it wasn't until about 60 years later that oceanographers realized once and for all by their own measurements, now it's standard in oceanography, that these points exist throughout the world's ocean. And they're central to organizing the pattern of the tides. They're tideless places, because they're zeros, places of no tide. Amphidromic points, he called them, running around. He was a philologist, a wordsmith and classical linguistic scholar, and he coined the term physicist. We owe it to him. Faraday asked, what shall we call ourselves? He didn't like the term physicist. He thought nobody could pronounce it. And it was criticized in a publication a few years later for its four sibilant consonants that fizz like a squib. But we are stuck with it. We can pronounce it now. There we are. Lines in three dimensions. Position, a wave, modulus and phase. Zeros. We're interested in the lines of zero. Think about the current. Imaginary part of psi star grad psi. That's the pointing vector, if you would go up to electromagnetism in this approximation. Gradient of phase. Well, of course, the lines of phase spread out like hedgehog, like the spokes of a wheel, and perpendicular to them, they encircle the lines, and that's why these things are called optical vortices, because another way of thinking about these is the current, it's the pointing vector, it's the local momentum, different ways of describing the same thing. And the direction of the vortex line is the vorticity, the curl of the current. Now, this exists everywhere, but it also exists along these lines, and then it gives you the direction of the vortex lines or the phase singularities. So here we've got such a phase singularity line, and here you've got the current circulating round. If you are in two dimensions, like you have a screen, if there's infrared and paraxial optics with lasers and the like, there's a natural direction perpendicular to which you put your screens, and then you can say, does this vector vorticity point up or point down? And that's what people mean when they talk about when they talk about topological charge. It's a bad concept because it really isn't a three-dimensional, there's no such thing as topological charge, but it's a useful two-dimensional picture. So, for example, if this is a plus one and that's a minus one, measuring the number of two pi's around, see the phase must change by two pi because these waves are single-valued, a number of two pi's, typically it's plus or minus one when viewed from the point of view of the normal to the surface. Then, of course, if you imagine this line moving or your surface moving such as to touch this vortex line horizontally and then disappear, that is interpreted as a plus and minus charge coming together and annihilating. But really, what you have is actually a line. Of course, if the wave is time-dependent, these lines move around, and that's interesting too, but I'm not going to describe it. Something recent, just a little bit of fun for technical stiffening of this talk, you can calculate the curvature of these current lines. I don't mean the curvature of the vortex lines, but the curvature of the current lines. What does that mean? Well, gradient of phase, call it W, local wave vector, it's the same thing, gradient of phase, then the curvature of a current line is the gradient perpendicular to the line of the logarithm of the modulus of this vector. And it decomposes in an interesting way. There are two parts to it. One depends on k. Now, if k is large, that's geometrical optics, and I'm talking about a varying medium as well. And this part then gives you the standard curvature of a ray in geometrical optics, because these current lines are the nearest thing to the rays of geometrical optics, and indeed, in the geometrical optics limit, that's what they become. But the other term describes what happens near a vortex. That's the opposite. That's where rho is zero. If you know the Madelung-Bohm de Broglie way of looking at quantum waves, this thing is called the quantum potential. It's in addition to the gradient of refractive index, there's this thing, gradient of this, and that's like a force. And that dominates near a zero and gives you these curvature being inversely proportional to distance, which is what happens when you when you're near a vortex line. So it's a kind of nice little general formula with a wavy bit and a ray bit, a bit like Einstein's 1909 formula for optical fluctuations, and then where there's a Maxwell bit and a photon bit. But there you are. Anyway, never mind the interpretation. If you're in three dimensions, you can ask about the topology of these vortex lines. Now, we knew, John Nye and I, long ago when we wrote the first paper identifying these phase singularities as generic features in waves of all kinds, we knew they could be curved, and we had cases where there were closed loops. But what we didn't know is whether they could be knotted or linked, and that's what Mark Dennis and I discovered that they can be. I want to show you a recipe for creating a class of knots. Torus knots. What are they? Well, you imagine a torus and imagine that you wind n times one way and n times in the other and you join up, and that gives you an interesting knot depending on m and n. So, for example, 2, 3 is a torus knot, and here's 3, 7. If m and n have a common factor, then you get a link. I'll show you in a minute. So that's a class of knots. It's not difficult to create mathematical functions, complex functions, whose zero lines are any shape you like. But it's not straightforward, and that's why we had to work hard, to find such functions which are solutions of wave equations, so you could see them in optics. Okay. Oh, here's a link, by the way. Yeah, that's a link. Well, what you would do, you start with an unperturbed wave whose phase singularities are a loop with of strength n and a threading line of strength m, and that's a very degenerate thing, and you can find such solutions by playing around with superpositions of Bessel beams. I won't tell you how. And then you perturb this with any non-singular wave, and then this explodes into the knot that you want plus some threading junk, an m stranded helix, but there's the mn knot that it turns into. Now, this was observed. Miles Paget liked the idea, and it was observed in this way. I'll tell you first what they are. They're, remember what they are. They're threads of black light. complicated fields, much too complicated to draw, but the skeleton of them are these zero lines. Okay, knotted nothings. Well, Miles Paget and his group made a hologram according to a recipe that we supplied. And such that, when you shine a laser on, you get downstream one of these knots. Enormously elongated, a few millimeters across and 600 millimeters, nearly a meter long. But you can measure it, and you can see this is a link, and that's a knot, and agreeing wonderfully well with computations from the properties of the hologram. And that's, they wrote a paper, they published it. No, it's our paper, and then their paper was published in Nature. There's something magical about these knots. You know very well, better than I do, that when you're in a laser lab, if the air is clean, you don't see the laser beams. So here, in the laser beams that you don't see, there are zeros, dark lines that you even more don't see. But you can nevertheless detect them by section, and that's what they did. Quite hard work. Well, now they've gone further, because Mark has very cleverly found ways of creating these knots, or at least some of them, without the threading stuff through, unthreaded knots, isolated knots. And I'll just show you some of their nice pictures, and the experimental pictures. There they are. It's very beautiful work. Vortex lines can change their topology. As you change a parameter, knots can unknot, or unknots can knot. And how does that happen? Well, there are three singularities involved, which is worth identifying. First of all, there are vortex lines. I hope they're black. Then there are lines of zero vorticity, call them be dashed. And then there are critical points of intensity, which lie on these zero vorticity lines. And what happens is, that as you change a parameter, these lines of zero vorticity, some of them are located on the zero lines of critical intensity, stationary points of intensity, are located on the zero vorticity line, and they move like a bead on a wire, and when they encounter a vortex line, which they can do, that's the moment when the vortex line is changing its topology. And there are different ways it can happen. Here's the parameters. A vortex loop can shrink to a point and disappear, or it can be a pair of hyperbolas which change their connectivity. And these two different things happen, and there are ways that you can describe very precisely. Just briefly, a slightly surreal event happened a couple of years ago, to which I had the privilege of being invited, in Venice, where two people, Fabrizio Tamburini, who's from Venice, and Bo Tide from Uppsala, were demonstrating what they called a new kind of radio based on phase singularities. And what this is they have a spiral antenna, spiral horn, which produces a beam which has a phase singularity in it. There it is on the other side of the Canale Grande, and they observed it in public in the St. Mark's Palace, in the Duke's Palace in Venice. Now, why do this? Because if at the same time you have a conventional antenna on the same frequency, then at the receiving end, using interferometry, you can easily detect separately the signals from the two antenna. And that's a way where, without any violating any fundamental bandwidth rules, you can get several signals using the same frequency. Now, to me as a theorist, this was no big deal. It's a rather simple exercise in interferometry. But people from the satellite broadcasting industry who were present at this demonstration were enormously impressed. And if it survives turbulence in the atmosphere, because it needs coherence, and it did survive the rather horrible turbulence on that particular day, if it would survive turbulence from a satellite down, then they found this exciting. I mean, it was a curious thing. Marconi's daughter, surprisingly alive, and came. It was a grand and, as I say, rather absurd ceremony. Funded by, let me tell you, the guy who has become very rich, replacing the wooden poles that the gondoliers tie their gondolas to by plastic poles. Okay. Which don't rot. That's the point. Very funny. Never mind. Okay. Well, of course, just as geometric caustics are approximations, they're not really singularities. I mean, when you go to wave physics, they're smoothed away. Optical vortices are artifacts. You see them because they're good approximations. Artifacts of the scalar wave approximation to the vector waves of electromagnetism. And, of course, the new concept that you introduce when you go from scalar to vector waves is polarization. So you ask, can there be polarization singularities? And the answer is yes, there can be. And here's how to describe them. You write the physical wave in the standard way as a real part of a complex vector field times the frequency. So this doesn't depend on frequency now. This is, for monochromatic waves, something static but space-varying. And you can write that as P plus IQ, two real vectors. Okay. Now that represents an ellipse at each point. Why? Well, we did in Born and Wolf, who talks about it in two dimensions. It's really more general. It represents an ellipse at every point because the vector, you take the real part, is P cos omega t plus Q sin omega t, and that's an ellipse. So as t varies, and it's the three-dimensional version of the familiar polarization ellipse. So a complex vector field is also a field of ellipses, and that's a nice way to think about polarization, because then the normal to the ellipse is P cross Q, or the imaginary part of E star cross E. Now, this immediately makes you realize, or it made John Nye realize, people hadn't thought about it before, in the 1980s, what the singularities are. There are two kinds. The ellipse could be a circle. This is the locus of pure circular polarization called C singularities. There's a condition for that. It's E dot E, not E star dot E. Two conditions. They're lines. Okay. And if you ask, what are the pattern of ellipses near to a polarization singularity? Well, there are three stable patterns. I won't go into the details of them, but here they are, a star, a lemon, and a monstar, we call them. Two of them have index plus a half, and one has index of minus a half. These are topologically distinct in ways I don't want to describe. They're points in the plane, and they're lines in three dimensions, as I said. There's a formula which tells you whether it's plus a half or minus a half. What does that mean? It means that as you go around, the polarization rotates by half, plus half, or minus half. Why half a time? Because this polarization is the same as that one. It's not a vector, it's a tensor quantity. So the natural singularities of index a half. You'll see a natural example of that in a moment. Or the ellipse could generate into a line. And there's a condition for that too. And the ellipse is degenerate. And near a line, on a line, it's the normal that's undefined. So if you ask what's the pattern of normal vectors near one of these lines, well, they're just the three Poincaré singularities. There they are. I don't want to go into the details of that. Well, they're lines in space. It's a little bit more complicated in the plane. I don't want to talk about it. But there's a nice, complicated, but usable formula people use in computation that tells you whether, just if I give you a formula for the field, whether the index is plus one or minus one. One, because these are vector fields. This, the thing that's undefined there that you need to know what happens nearby is the direction of the normal. Okay, so here's a field, and x, y, and z, which has a C line in it. Now I've taken a particular section, and here are two C points, and I've drawn here the long axis lines of the polarization ellipse. No arrows, because they're not vectors. So here's a singularity of plus half, here's a minus a half. Here's a different field concocted, which has an L line, and it pierces the plane, and this is the pattern of normal vectors, and here you see a Poincaré singularity of plus one and minus one. So these are the singular, and they're typical. So when your TV signal is in your room, there are lines of this type in the room moving around, which we hoped, hasn't happened so far, will be used by engineers as ways of mapping out the skeleton of complicated vector fields. By the way, this is the electric field. The magnetic field has similar singularities, but they needn't coincide, and they're interestingly related. I won't tell you about it. But there's one in the sky. I wanted to show you this. Daylight is polarized, you all know that. It's polarized because it's essentially single scattering of sunlight by air molecules. Right, and it's linearly polarized, as I say, it's dipole scattered radiation from air molecules. Well, according to Rayleigh's theory, just from the transversality of light, the polarization is strongest at right angles to the sun, and you've all done this with a piece of Polaroid. You rotate it and you see the light go bright and dark, near the sun not. So near the sun is an unpolarized point, and there'll be another unpolarized point at the anti-sun, just after the sun has set, you would see that. However, that's not what's observed. What was observed by Arago in 1817 was that the unpolarized point isn't at the sun. Now, from a modern point of view, this is somewhat surprising, because if you go round once, you turn once, and that's a singularity of strength 1. You don't expect that in polarization. You expect a singularity of strength 1/2, because that's the simplest way you can go from one polarization to the same polarization. There's something unstable about it. And so there's Arago. Babinet observed a point above the sun. Arago's was above the anti-sun. Brewster observed an unpolarized point below the sun and conjectured that below the anti-sun there would be one. You have to see that after sunset. It wasn't observed till recently, and this was observed by people going up in a balloon, where you can see after sunset a bit of the sky that's relevant. So 4 singularities, and so this is what really happens. You get a singularity of index 1/2, the polarization fingerprint, we call it, because it's like a fingerprint. There it is, the pattern of polarization, a half index singularity. 4 of them, 4 times 1/2 is 2, and it's a standard piece of mathematics that any field smoothly on a sphere has index plus 2. And that's why if you had hair, I don't, you could comb it, you can't comb it without singularities. Good. Well, Mark Dennis and I calculated in a very simple model, the simplest model you can make, paying attention to the singularities, we calculated the pattern of polarization in the sky. And we collaborated with Raymond Lee, who is a little bit embarrassed when you say his name quickly, and it's Rayleigh, not Lord, from Annapolis, who did measurements of the sky. And this is what we found. Now, these lines are the these lines are the observed directions of polarization of the whole sky. Here's the sun, and the blue is our theory, and it agrees very well. And these blue lines are the contours of an elliptic integral. So the lines of constant this thing, never mind the details of it, are in fact these lines that give you the lines of polarization in the sky. So, you know, elliptic integrals, when you encounter them, they seem rather arcane, but there's one above you on every sunny day. It's a kind of remarkable thing. I wish I had time to speak up more of this, but I don't. There's the Babinet and the Arago points. And, okay, now to finish with, if I may, I mean, it's getting on slightly, but can you give me a few more minutes? Yeah? I want to, in a sense, give you a punchline. I mean, these singularities form a hierarchy, as you've seen. I mean, there's optics is a very well-developed science in that there are these different levels at which you can study it, and each level draws your attention to different classes of phenomena. And the singularities at each level of physics get dissolved when you go to the next level, and the theory is then replaced by a deeper one. And we've seen this happening today. The caustic singularities of ray optics are smoothed away in scalar wave optics by diffraction. But then you get a new concept, which is phase, once you have waves, and that has its own singularities, namely optical vortices. Now, and when you go to vector wave optics, there are too many variables, components of a field, to stably have them all vanish and give you phase singularities. Of course, if you have a particular polarized component, that's a scalar wave, you do have vortices, but in general the vector field doesn't. But now you've got polarization singularities. So can you continue this? Well, let's stay with scalar wave optics for the moment, because beneath this, you all know very well, is quantum optics. And it turns out that the dark light of a phase singularity in optical vortex is a window, and it opens up to our eyes, or it would do if you would do the experiment, the glimmering of the quantum vacuum. And I want to show you how that happens. It's not very complicated, actually. But what it tells you is that optical vortices have quantum cores. So think of a mode, U, in some cavity, maybe, with some frequency, with a vortex at the origin, going through the origin, containing many photons. It's classical light. And no other modes are occupied. They're all in their vacuum states. And you explore this mode using an excited atom, the quantum counter in Mandel's book, that can decay with frequencies near the frequency of your light that you're interested in, and ask what's the intensity of the light that's emitted if the atom is in different places. Well, it's the expectation value of an operator from quantum optics, and the operator is sum over these creation operators with the mode structures. And you can do that calculation. But in words, mostly the intensity will be dominated by stimulated emission. Of course, the atom will see the light that's there. But if there's no light there, if you're near a vortex, then you'll see what is otherwise negligible. You'll see stimulated emission to all the unoccupied vacuum states that don't have a vortex where your atom is. And there's a formula which you can write down. There's the stimulated emission. It's proportional to the strength of the wave that you're looking at. And near a vortex, where the wave grows linearly, the square is quadratic. And then this describes a spontaneous emission into all the non-vortex modes within the line width of the atomic level that you're interested in, or transition that you're interested in. Now, the simplest question to ask is, how big is this quantum core? Well, you can calculate it. It's the core within which spontaneous emission dominates stimulated emission. And there's a formula. Okay, what's involved? Planck's constant, because it's quantum. Frequency, delta omega, that's the atom. This is quantum mechanics, so what you see depends on how you make the measurement, and this is the atom. And then this is speed of light, and this is the geometry of the vortex. Well, you can calculate it for a Laguerre-Gauss beam, like this laser beam, if you put it through a spiral phase plate with a hole in it, with a waste radius, you focus it down, and you have a power, how many watts or milliwatts. And the Institute of Physics had a meeting recently, and they gave little lasers with a little description. And they were very embarrassed when I pointed out to them, a little piece of paper tells you that instead of it not, because of health and safety, it didn't exceed 1 milliwatt, it didn't exceed 1 megawatt. That would have drawn attention for our secret services, I think. Anyway, that nice formula in terms of these quantum core radius, and for a beam like this, 5 milliwatts, if you focus it down to 100 microns, not difficult to do, and if you would use a hydrogenic atom to detect it, then this quantum core would be about a micron. Okay, that's an interesting thing to look at. Interestingly, rather similar considerations apply to sound. Now, why sound? Well, it's very different physics, but the principle is still that the approximation where you would have acoustic vortices in this room there, these lines moving around too fast, lines of zero, too fast for you not to hear them, fleeting threads of silence, but still air is not a continuum. It's a it's molecules are there. Even when there's no sound, any detector would have Brownian motion on it, and that includes your eardrum. And interesting to ask how big the acoustic core of a acoustic vortex would be, the acoustic core corresponding to this Brownian motion. And you can do a calculation. Human ear is good because it's a broadband detector. It's different from the atom I just talked about, different physics, of course. typical sound waves, wavelength lambda and d decibels, okay? And there's a nice calculation you can do, and there are some simplifying factors. We know about the statistics of random waves. Roughly, there's about, the vortices are separated by half a wavelength, roughly speaking. It's more complicated than that, but roughly. 0 decibels is the faintest audible sound of a standard human ear at a certain frequency. And 0 decibels happens to correspond, for a sensible, the understandable evolutionary reason, to the strength of Brownian motion on the eardrum. It's an exercise I used to give to students. They never could do it. To confirm this, calculate the strength of Brownian motion, how many decibels is it? And it's about 0. Typical eardrum. When you do that, you get a nice formula. The acoustic core is the wavelength divided by 10 to the 1 plus the number of decibels over 20. So if it's 500 hertz, typical sound, 40 decibels, typical musical performance, it's about half a millimeter. Now, Miles Paget thinks he's detected that. He made an acoustic vortex by shining sound onto a spiral, a helical surface, and then took a microphone into the center. I'm not convinced that he really did detect Brownian motion. It's kind of subtle, because there's also electronic noise in your circuits, which could easily masquerade as what you want to see, and I'm not quite convinced he did it right, and that remains to be confirmed. But anyway, it's an interesting phenomenon, illustrating this general principle of the deeper theory, blurring the singularities. The sound doesn't go to zero, the light doesn't go to zero, for different physical reasons, but you can calculate the radius of the core. Now to finish, well, you get the message. There is this hierarchy of singularities, beautifully described by something that Maxwell wrote when he was 23. He didn't write it with this in mind. He was talking about science generally, but it applies very well to this hierarchy of optical phenomena, the singularities that you see on different scales. He wrote, this was his private notebook, young man, 23, "The dimmed outlines of phenomenal things all merge into one another unless we put on the focusing glass of theory and screw it up first to one pitch of definition and then to another, so as to see down into different depths through the great millstone of the world." Thank you.